morning. God is good. All the time. Just a couple announcements. Summer special music, if any of you are inclined or so desire to do some special music or know somebody that can do special music for the summer, please contact Mary or Rashad and get that scheduled. I have a note here on behalf of Matt and Debbie Cox. They would like to thank you for all your prayers, cards, and thoughts as they continue to grieve Deb's dad's death. Also, on the back table is the sign-up for Ladies Nights Out on June 9th. So if you want us to go to that Ann and Tony's in West Jefferson, please sign up on that. And in the bulletin was a thank you about the food pantry. We finished off the month. We still need coordinators, either one person or family or a couple families going together and do the coordinating of that. And of course you get all the help from everybody else, but if you work together, we can get that done for the next time that'll be coming up. So if you're interested in coordinating, see me and I can give you more details and hopefully get a coordinator. If we don't, we'll probably have to bow out of that food pantry ministry if nobody's willing to take that over the next time. And I think that's it.
Thank you. brief word of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Continue with our opening hymn.
Thank you. victory for our God. Alleluia.
By the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live.
For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Signs that you do, because God is with it. So that's pretty evident. From there, the conversation becomes confusing, because while Nicodemus claims to know that Jesus is from God, Jesus tells Nicodemus that no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born from above, Anathan. But Nicodemus, proving Jesus' point, hears not from above, but one must be born again. That is, a person must be born a second time naturally, like the first. Jesus says spirit, and Nicodemus hears wind. By the time Jesus gets done with him, Nicodemus is confused and muttering, how can these things be? Perhaps Nicodemus' problem is right there from the very beginning. Coming to Jesus with Rabbi, we know. I think one of Jesus' points to Nicodemus is that it's not about what we think we know. Rather, it's about what God does. The two births are similar in this one respect. In neither are we the main actor. One birth is natural, the other is spiritual, yet both are outside of our control. In one, our parents decide that they would like to have a child, and you are the fruit of their love. And that's a marvelous and wonderful thing. In the other, God decided to heal the breach between God and human beings, and would do so through the death and resurrection of his Son, making the cross and resurrection tangible for us through the water and word of holy baptism, where in addition to dying to our old self, our old sinful nature, we are marked with the cross of Christ and sealed with the Holy Spirit forever. And are being born from above through holy baptism. It is not our will that is being fulfilled. It is God's will that is being accomplished and fulfilled. Now, Bruce Marlene and Richard Rohrbaugh write about the importance of birth and birth status in their commentary. They remind us it's critical to recognize that the topic here is all about birth. Birth status was the single all-important factor in determining a person's honor status in the society. Ascribed honor, the honor derived from one's status at birth, was simply a given. It usually stayed with a person for their entire life. To be born over again, born for a second time, however unthinkable that might have been, would alter one's ascribed birth status in a very fundamental and profound way. A new ascribed honor status would derive from a new birth, thus a second birth, especially if it derived the difference substantially in honor from the first, would be a life-changing event of staggering proportions. Now, to be born from above, that is, to be born of the sky, of the realm of God, is to belong to that realm, to become a veritable child of God. This, of course, is to acquire an honor status of the very highest sort. Thus, whatever honor status a person might have in Israelite society, being born from above would recreate that person at a whole new level. In addition, since all children of the same father share that father's honor status, differences and status among the children of God obviously disappear. We have the same father. We have the same birth status. We're all equal in Jesus Christ. Except there's one that's unequal, and that is the firstborn, the first fruits of the resurrection. He has a higher status than we. That night, as Nicodemus talked with Jesus, he began with what he knew. He ended with questions about what he did not know. He arrived fairly confident that he had a good grasp, a good handle on who this Jesus was. He left having been encountered by the mysterious, majestic Word of God in the flesh. In the Nicene Creed, dating from the 4th century AD, we confess, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things seen and unseen. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son, begotten of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. Before Nicodemus departed, Jesus shared with him the gospel, the good news of God's intervention into our history, into our world of sin and death, to buy us back from eternal death and eternal separation from God the Father through his own sacrifice of his own life. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up." Think of that. Now, he went back to the Old Testament. He went back to the First Testament. And he grabbed this image. The Israelites are wandering in the wilderness. And they had sinned against the Lord. And the Lord God had allowed serpents, asps, poisonous snakes to inhabit their camp. And many were bitten by the snakes, and they died. And so they come to Moses. Notice they don't pray to God themselves. They come to Moses and pray him that he will pray to God on their behalf. And Moses does. And God tells Moses to make a serpent out of bronze and to put it on a pole. And if anyone is bitten by the snakes, they're going to look at the pole and believe by looking, they will not die and they will be healed from the snake bite and they will live. Now, isn't that interesting? I know we say, oh, that's synthetic magic. No. God already knew way back then that his son was going to die on a tree, a cross. And that everybody would look at him and believe that he died for you would have life in Jesus' name. I mean, why didn't God just say, snakes be gone? I forgive you. I hear your prayer. Just be gone. They appeared. They could just disappear out of sight and be gone forever. No. No. They still bit people. But he gave them a sign so that if they were bitten by the snakes, they could look at this snake on the pole, believing by looking that they would be healed and they would live and they would live. I just find that fascinating. But aren't we, when we talk about ourselves, as Luther did in Latin, it's similius, we are similius epicator. That means we're simultaneously a saint, forgiving sinner, and a real sinner. Both held in tension at the same time. Now some churches teach that once you come to Christ, once you're baptized, you never sin again. Hey, you know me, and I know you. Do we need to say anything else? That's to live with a fallacy in the lie. We continue to sin. Now, many of us are heartbroken when we do. And that's good, right, and salutary. Do we not confess our sin every Sunday corporately and receive the promise of forgiveness from our Father in heaven? Absolutely. Luther would say his prayers and ask for forgiveness every night before he went to sleep. So if he died during the night, he knew that he had confessed his sins and he would die in peace. And when he got up in the morning, he would say his prayers, confess his sins. I don't know what sins he committed during the night, but just in case, confess his sins. So that as he walked through the day, he would walk in God's strength and peace and mercy and promise of grace. So he could go out and live boldly for Christ. We're simultaneously a saint and a sinner. That's why the saints didn't go away. Because when God uses that image to say, when I'm lifted up, everybody who looks at me, Jesus says, and believes that my death was for them, they are forgiven in my name. Because we continue to sin. Continue to need to come to the foot of the cross to lay our sins before Jesus, to seek forgiveness. Now, it's not license. It's not license. It's not, oh, I love to sin, God loves to forgive. This is a great situation. You know, I just go to Mass, I just go to confession, I go out and leave. You know, I just come into here and I'll confess my sins, nobody's around, I'll confess, or I confess on the golf course, or I'm fishing, wherever I have to be, and life is good. I just go on my merry way. No. We're new creatures in Christ Jesus. Made new. It's about a death and a resurrection. So it's not license. But it is an acknowledgement that as long as I live in the flesh, there's always an opportunity for me to fall in the ditch. And it does happen to each and every one of us. Not because we're wanting to happen, or looking for it to happen, but it does. And every time we come to confession and we look to Jesus, we know that by God's grace, that's His honor, love, and favor toward us, that we are forgiven. It was so important to Luther that he thought of John 3:16 as the gospel in miniature. And here, Jesus says too, and just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in Him may have eternal life. So the snake in the desert and the pole in the desert was for this life. They'd have lived life. They wouldn't die of snake life. But when you look to Jesus, you're looking to Jesus not only for life now, but for eternal life. Hey, that's better. For God so loved the world, the whole world. And remember in Genesis, when Adam and Eve sinned, where did really the lightning strike? Where was the strike? Yes, women got the bad news of childbirth pain. They got that. And you know, the earth is going to have it's going to have weeds and thorns and thistles and all that jazz. So you're going to have to work really hard to have a garden. Yes, we understand that. We get that. But the real thing that happened is the earth, the creation, took the hit. Not man and woman, but creation took the hit. The whole cosmos took the hit. For our sin, everything got cursed. The earth, the world got cursed. And sin and death came in to live among us and to be a part of us. So Jesus said, God so loved the world. He could have said, well, God so loved human beings. No. He said, for God so loved the world. Didn't Paul say that the creation groaned for our redemption? Because when we're redeemed, so is all the cosmos. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through Him. Those who believe in Him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. It's wonderful that our Lord gave us that gospel encapsulated in such a few words that it's easy for all of us to carry it around with us in our memory. And every time we witness a baptism or come and receive Holy Communion, we experience the power and presence of the Holy Spirit in with and under word and water, bread and wine. God shapes us inside of community, inside the sacraments, and inside the Word made flesh within us. Another way of saying it is this. Remember Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like a field. And a guy goes out and he discovers this fabulous treasure in the field. So he sells everything he has and he purchases that field so that he might gain the treasure. Or it's like a pearl, a great price a guy finds in the market. And it's so fabulous. He sells everything else he's got. So he'll go and buy that one pearl in the marketplace. He said, the kingdom of God is like that. Or in another way, it's like saying Jesus is the treasure hidden in the field, as it were, for which we are willing to sell everything in order to buy that field. For to be in Christ is everything. And so with God's help and by His grace, we die to ourselves daily, rising to newness of life and our Lord's forgiveness. And all of life that is lived is our thank you. Not for credit. Men are bad at this, you know that, right? They always want credit from their wives. I get credit for that?
I
dusted the house. Is there credit for that?
No.
I have to dust the house all the time, you know. Well, I picked up the dog poo in the backyard. Do I get credit for that? No, no credit for that. You can't get credit anywhere. Well, take heart. You don't get it in the kingdom either. You're just doing what you were supposed to do all along, but finally got around to doing something. Teacher, thank you. Thank you for loving me, Father. Thank you for giving me your Son. Thank you for giving me forgiveness and eternal life. Thank you for the Holy Spirit to live within me in my broken flesh. Thank you for making this walk with me. Thank you for putting your angels around me to guard me and watch over me. Thank you for giving me a congregation to be a part of. Thank you for a great cloud of witnesses that surround me from every place and of every time. And you make me a part of that fabulous, incredible group of humanity that are your folk. Thank you. Thank you. When that happens and all of life is lived as our thanks to the praise, honor, and glory of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen.
Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us, for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified and cross by fire. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for both the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, with the prophet Isaiah, hear us as we pray. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give to your whole church, our sister congregation in NALC, and our own congregation the boldness to bear witness to Jesus as our crucified and risen Savior. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise you for the new life that is poured out upon all who are born anew in the water and the Spirit of holy baptism. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, renew us daily and help all the baptized to let their light shine before others, that you alone may be glorified. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise and thank you for the gift of education, the gift of learning, and for the wonder of a curious mind. In the upcoming summer recess, grant renewal to teachers, school administrators, and students. Pour out your blessing upon those beginning internships, as well as those graduates looking for employment or heading on for future study. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise you for your love for the world that was made known in the death of our only begotten Son, Jesus. We pray for those who suffered for the sake of the gospel, especially for the Muslims throughout the Middle East and North Africa, who have become Jesus followers and who have been martyred for their new faith. May the eyes of all people, especially our enemies, turn to him and be saved. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise, thank, and glorify you, Holy Father, that you are eager to hear our prayers. We pray for those who are sick, those who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, as well as those suffering that is not known or seen by others, but only unto you. We lift before your throne of grace our homebound, our church family and friends in need of healing, strength, and comfort. Those named in our bulletin or on our prayer chain, and those we have named aloud or in the quiet of our own hearts. We especially pray, Lord, that you take into your comforting arms the family of Dan Downing, as his niece, Molly Murphy, age 3, drowned yesterday. We know she is in your protective arms, and we ask that those arms also be with the Downing and Murphy family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise, thank, and glorify you, most high and holy God, for the witnesses of saints who have preceded us, especially those who most recently died. Comfort all who mourn with the sure and certain hope of the resurrection into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I fight to share Christ's own peace one with another.
Thank you. So don't worry about it. I thought, oh, you're sensitive.
Mary, that's peace be with you.
Our God.
persons equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, yet one Lord, one God, ever to be adored in your everlasting glory. And so the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of a godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you in favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
resurrected Lord.
Thanks be to God.